Welcome to another edition of Infowars Nightly News. I'm your host, Rob Dew, and get ready. We're about to get real serious. The tyranny is coming down hard. Here's a look at what we have coming up tonight.
Tonight, the UN arms trade treaty that has been identified as a flagrant threat to the Second Amendment, and which Barack Obama is determined to sign, has its roots in a 1961 State Department memorandum, which explains how the United Nations will oversee complete disarmament of the American people.
From my cold, dead hands.
All that plus more up next on the InfoWars Nightly News.
Last week, Aaron Dykes covered how the UN has been incrementally trying to dig into our Second Amendment. Well, guess what? It's hitting home now because we just released a story today titled UN Gun Grab Follows State Department Plan. This is going to get scary. The UN arms trade treaty that has been identified by observers as a flagrant threat to the Second Amendment, in which Barack Obama is determined to sign, has its roots in a 1961, you hear that, 1961 State Department memorandum, which explains how the United Nations will oversee complete disarmament of all the people under the ruse of preventing war. Are you hearing me? That's what they're talking about. They're going to take your guns under the ruse of preventing war. Let's go to that document. We'll come back to this in 1 second. Here's the document. It's entitled Freedom from War, State Department Publication 7277, released September 1961. Okay? September 1961 is when they started writing this. And you know what it says here? The United States Program for General and Complete Disarmament and a Peaceful World. Yeah, the only ones that are going to have guns are the United Nations soldiers. And guess what? There's not going to be any peace with them. They're going to be kicking your heads in and shooting everybody in sight. And they've already done it. It's happened time and time again. You can look in Africa. You can look in East Asia. That's what they plan on doing. That's their version of peacekeeping. We're going to go into this document right now. From the Office of Public Services, Bureau of Public Affairs. This only cost 15 cents. It was interesting. In 1961. So in their introduction, they talk about a program for general and complete disarmament in a peaceful world. Okay, make no mistake about it. This isn't just hidden one time in this document. We're going to go through it all. They talk about freedom from war and security for all states. And what does security for the state mean? That means no security for the individual. That means you don't have any rights. It's only the state that's going to have rights. First, there must be immediate disarmament action. And this is written by our State Department. A goal of general and complete disarmament. Second, all disarmament obligations must be subject to effective international controls. You know what that means? No Second Amendment. They talk about the stages of the disarmament process. Third, adequate peacekeeping machinery must be established. Nations are unlikely to shed their means of self-protection in the absence of alternative ways to safeguard their legitimate interests, like freedom from tyranny. This can only be achieved through progressive strengthening of international institutions under the United Nations and by creating United Nations Peace Force to enforce the peace as the disarmament process proceeds. You guys, you better get serious. You better start talking to people. You better start warning people because it's going to start happening soon. We know they're already training to do this. We've already been telling you this for years, okay? And here it is from 1961, and it's been incrementally happening. Let's go back to the document. Disarmament goals and objectives. Preserve internal order and contributions to a United Nations peace force. So that's taxes that they're going to use from us to go back and take your guns later through the United Nations, through the blue hats. Establishment and effective operation of an internal disarmament organization within the framework of the United Nations to ensure compliance at all times with all disarmament obligations. Okay? Governing principles. We're going to move down here. Inspection and verification must establish both that nations carry out scheduled limitations or reductions and that they do not retain armed forces and armaments in excess of those permitted at any stage of the disarmament process. There it is, right there, in the document. Here we go on page 4. Arms and armed forces would be reduced. The armed forces of the United States and the Soviet Union would be limited to 2.1 million men each, with appropriate levels not exceeding the amount for other militarily significant states. Levels of armaments would be correspondingly reduced, and their production would be limited. This is all by a world body. This is not going to be through anything through our country. This is through the United Nations, which means there's no negotiations. There's only killing people and machine gunning them when they don't comply. States would be committed to other measures to reduce international tension and to protect the chance of war by accident, miscalculation, or surprise attack. And they go through a second stage and a third stage. Here we go in the third stage. The manufacture of armaments would be prohibited except for those agreed types and quantities to be used by the UN Peace Force and those required to maintain internal order. All other armaments would be destroyed or converted to peaceful purposes. This all sounds beautiful and glowing in your new world order, but you know what it's going to be? It's going to be used to come in and take your wealth, take your property, take everything you have. And they're going to start by taking your guns. Here we go to the Declaration on Disarmament. The United States program, let's get a shot of this. People aren't going to believe it till they see it. Here it is right here. This is their appendix, a Declaration on Disarmament. The United States program for general and complete disarmament in a peaceful world. The nations of the world, conscious of the crisis in human history produced by a revolutionary development of modern weapons within a world divided by serious ideological differences. That means those who are for freedom and those who want to take everything from you and live lavish while you live as a slave. Determined to save present and succeeding generations from the scourge of war and the dangers and burdens of the arms race, and to create conditions in which all people can strive freely and peacefully to fulfill their basic aspirations as long as they kneel to the New World Order, declare their goal to be a free, secure, and peaceful world of independent states. That it will not happen. There will be no independent states. Adhering to the common standards of justice and international conduct and subjecting the use of force to the rule of law, a world where adjustment to change takes place in accordance with the principles of the United Nations, which means nobody has guns, and everybody listens to the United Nations, a world where we shall be a permanent state of general and complete disarmament under effective international control, and where the resources of nations shall be devoted to man's material, cultural, and spiritual advance, set forth as the objectives under a program of general and complete disarmament in a peaceful world. So what does all that mean? Well, that means they're going to take your guns, and once they take your guns, you're not going to have any type of freedom of speech. You're not going to have any type of freedom of the press. You're not going to have anything. And we already reported on this before. I want to go back to the UN gun grab follows State Department plan. This came out today from Paul Joseph Watson, dated Monday, July 16th, 2012. There's the article. You can go read it all on Infowars.com. They link to a Forbes article under here. It's the UN Arms Treaty has caused so much controversy because it outlines a plan to target all types of conventional weapons, notably small arms and light weapons, according to Forbes' Larry Bell. There's the Forbes article. So even Forbes is saying they're coming after your Second Amendment. All right, and Forbes isn't known for protecting the Second Amendment at all. They also have a quote from U.S. Ambassador to the UN, John Bolton, who said probably the first intelligent thing I've ever heard him say. He also warns that the agreement is trying to act as though it is really just a treaty about international arms trade between nation states, but there is no doubt that the real agenda here is domestic firearms control. Okay? They're talking about your small guns. They're talking about the guns that can be used in a guerrilla war against the United Nations when they come to invade and send troops from other countries here to take your guns. That's what it's talking about. But you know what? You don't believe me, do you? You're still in denial, aren't you? Those who are out there in denial. Well, let's go to a clip. It's going to start off with the New Orleans chief of police during Katrina saying, no one will be allowed to have guns. All weapons will be taken. And then it's going to go to today's show where Mike Adams got a call from someone who was actually in Katrina with the 45th Infantry Brigade. I'm sorry I'm flustered because this information is really disturbing me right now. He was there confiscating guns. They were going door to door. They were kicking in as they asked, do you need any assistance? Boom. Do you have any guns? We're taking them.
You said guns will be taken?
Yeah, no one will be able to be armed. We will take all weapons. Today in New Orleans, they got a lot tougher on the holdouts.
Police department at your home!
Not only the flooded areas, but New Orleans' driest and wealthiest neighborhoods, too.
Police department!
The police and National Guard going street by street, house to house, sometimes entering open houses with guns drawn, and instructions to disarm anyone inside.
Let's go to Chris in Oklahoma. Chris, you're on the air on the Alex Jones Show. Thanks for joining us.
Hey, Hells Ranger. How's it been?
Good. It's good here, man. How about yourself?
Oh, pretty good. Pretty good. I was with the 45th Infantry Brigade and Delta Company, first at the 279, second platoon. During Hurricane Katrina, I'm kind of calling in on yesterday's subject. I'm sorry about that.
It's all right.
But, it's just, I've always wanted to get a hold of you guys and kind of get the word out there for those that still have that slight hesitation in the back of their head that gun confiscation can't and won't happen here. It already has. And I was only 21 years old, just really gung-ho, really dedicated to the Army, especially to the infantry. And I did whatever I was told.
And what did they ask you to do?
The first thing we did was we got a book full of 3-week-old 911 phone calls, right? And then we had to go around and answering all the phone calls. So we were like cadaver dogs for about 3 weeks. And in between them, we would run night missions. And here's the thing. A lot of people may think that they'll see this on the news or they'll have time to get ready when the crap hits the fan or whatever. It's just, it's a truck, you know what I mean? It's a group of trucks. They pull up, they stack right on your home, as we did, and we broke entry. Yeah, we would yell out, Oklahoma Army National Guard, is anybody in need of assistance? But that's as we were booting in the door.
But wait a minute, it sounds like you weren't part of the Oklahoma National Guard. I mean, you were U.S. military.
Yeah, I was activated, I think about a week after Katrina. I was watching it on the news, and Sheriff Kamiko of Fox 23 told me before my unit even got a hold of me that I was going to New Orleans.
So we got
sent in, and we were the very, very first boots on the ground, Alpha Company.
And you were confiscating firearms?
Left and right, yes. And we were also monitoring the New Orleans police because we kept having, like, you know, like the first day we had this little beautiful redheaded lady come up.
All right, wait a minute. We're almost out of time. Will you stay on the line for us, please? I want to continue with you on the other side. Stay on the line with us. This is fascinating. We're going to continue this right here on the Alex Jones Show. We'll be right back.
That happened today in this wealthy neighborhood where homeowners had armed themselves to protect their mansions. Residents were handcuffed on the ground. In the end, police took their weapons but let them stay in their homes.
They were a little bit threatened because our weapons were bigger than their weapons.
Chris Montgomery says he'd rather be in Iraq than patrolling American neighborhoods.
Walking up and down these streets, you don't want to think about the stuff that you're going to have to do if somebody pops around the corner.
Let me shoot in America.
Yeah.
We have Chris on the line from Oklahoma relating a story about gun confiscation in New Orleans and that entire region following Hurricane Katrina several years ago. And Chris, go ahead. You were saying, you were describing how you and your team were kicking in doors and confiscating firearms from people. Did anybody resist? Did anybody ever shoot back? What happened?
Well, we had a couple of people resist verbally, and they got stuffed and cuffed very violently. We throw them in the back of the 5-ton or the deuce and a half or whatever, and then we'd take them out to the Greyhound bus station, which was the police station at the time. Before we came up, or before the break, I think it was like the second day we were there, this redheaded lady came up to our platoon's area, and she sat, or to our company area, she sat on the curb with her knees in her chest, just rocking back and forth, crying uncontrollably. She sat there for almost 27 hours, just refused to move. We talked to her, we did everything we could, just didn't want to, you know, you could tell she had been through enough. She'd been repeatedly raped by men in NOPD masks and NOPD uniforms.
Oh, you're kidding me.
So we were told, you know, at that point we were told the NOPD obviously isn't our friend, we need to start watching them. The FBI had us out there at Cooter Brown, which is the NOPD Sheriff's Brother's Bar. It's like the big cop bar there in New Orleans.
Just so people know, NOPD is New Orleans Police Department, just for people who know.
Yeah, definitely. Not the police department.
So a lot of those cops were then just total rogue. I mean, we saw a video of some of them going in and looting retail stores and things like that, but they were raping women down there?
Definitely raping women. They were. We got two separate women that came to our company alone. And when I was there, I met cats from the California Guard, Indiana Guard, you name it. Everybody was. And
but how
it was just a free for all. Police from all over the country, Dallas County, Dallas, Texas sheriffs down there.
But how did you and your team justify to yourselves and each other that gun confiscation would help this situation when it was a free for all? I mean, isn't that a time when citizens need to be able to defend themselves?
It never, you know, like I said, I was just ignorant as hell. And that's kind of something that I worry about with the kids today, you know, if they really realize what they're doing. You know, I had no idea. The only time it ever occurred to me that something may be wrong is we came up, we were down by the old French district. We came up to this man's house. He had a big wooden sign that says, "I'm here alone with my dog and my shotgun. Looters beware." We thought, you know, it's funny. Everyone stopped and took pictures of the sign. But eventually we took his guns. And we left him there with nothing.
So now that you know what you know, now that you're listening to the Alex Jones Show and you're informed, what would you advise people to do if this happens again?
Well, I called. I mean, no offense. I mean, Mike, we love everything you do. I'm a big fan of the Health Ranger. But I was hoping to get a hold of Alex for the fact that what do you do when they stack right? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And they're prepped to come into the home. There's no negotiating with us. Trust me. There was no negotiating.
Yeah.
If you resisted, you died. That were the orders. You go for gunner, you die.
Yeah, but well, I mean, this is invaluable information. I apologize. We only have limited time here. I got to let you go. We've got so much more coming up here. But fascinating. I hope you call back and get to Alex as well. You know, I'll pass on this conversation to Alex and let him know, but that's some frightening information. And it's, I just hope that the military, that the members of the military say no, they refuse to engage in gun confiscation, because no doubt there could be outbreaks of violence and a lot of needless death and bloodshed if that happens. But thank you for your call, Chris. That's very concerning.
It was traumatic. All of a sudden, they were banging on the front door, the side door, and the back door, and they said, "Let us in." I'm saying, "Look at all my food. I got plenty of food." They kept pushing me back, and ended up like this.
Then, Patty showed them a small revolver she was carefully holding in the palm of her hand. A camera crew was there to capture what unfolded next.
I said, "It's not even loaded," and I dropped it on the floor.
You got a gun.
Well, they punched me in the face.
Relax now.
Look at my black and blue marks. Look at.
You said guns will be taken.
Yeah, no one will be able to be armed. We will take all weapons. Sir.
So if you're still doubting, there's the proof there. They went into New Orleans. They went into the high and dry areas. They went in just to grab guns because that's what they were training to do. It wasn't about helping people. It was about taking people's guns to see if they could get away with it under a crisis. And that's how it's going to happen. It's going to happen in the dead of night. Did you hear the soldier talking? He said, "We pulled up at night and we just busted in and grabbed guns." That's how they do it. They're not going to be, "Hey, please turn in your guns." No, it's going to be right down to the wire, and you're not even going to know that they're going to be there until they're on top of you while you're sleeping in your bed. So you better start making a plan. You better start having firearms. You better start learning how to shoot. You better start getting ammo. Because if you don't exercise the Second Amendment, it will be taken from you. And when the Second Amendment goes, it's you in tyranny. It's boots on your forehead. It's slave internment camps. And it's all going to happen. They've all been making plans. Remember in July, early July, July 6th? We had the article by Paul Joseph Watson. Army manual outlines plans to kill rioters and demonstrators in America. Newly leaked U.S. Army military police training manual for civil disturbance operations, that means here in the United States, outlines how military assets will be used domestically to quell riots, confiscate firearms, and even kill Americans on soil during mass civil unrest. Warning shots will not be fired. And that he linked to a Hong Kong document, and we can go to that, and it shows you some of the things they're going to use. Oh, there's the grenade launchers they're going to use against you. There's the little round that they're going to put in there as they shoot at you. Okay? That's what it's all about. It's all about you. It's all about them creating the crisis. And then they come at you and take your guns because the crisis has been created. It's unfolding right now. Okay? The economy is going down the tubes. everywhere in Austin, they have these free or so-called free money title loans things where they give you free money or so-called, but then they come and take your property. Those only happen when there's a bad economy and when people don't have jobs, and they're springing up everywhere like weeds, okay? And they're brand new and they're painted and they just, boom, they pop up. There's five of them right around my house. And I live in a pretty decent area of town, but it just says everybody's hurting. And when people start hurting, people start doing crazy things. Just like Gerald Celente says, when they lose everything, they lose it. And that's going to be the pretext to come in and start taking people's guns, and the Army's going to be kicking in doors, and they're training the National Guard to do it, and they're training the military police to do it, and they're training your SWAT teams, and they're giving them giant battle tanks to do it. It's all coming down. One more article I want to get to. Army Corps trained soldiers to confiscate constitutionally protected firearms. That was from Kurt Nemo the same day we released the other one, right? And we got that from the guys over at Hong Kong. Dan Feit sent that to us. And in addition to revealing how federal government and Pentagon will respond to civil disturbances in violation of the 1878 Posse Comitatus Act, the United States Military Police Schools Civil Disturbance Operations document instructs how military will confiscate Americans' weapons from American citizens. I'm sorry. I'm not reading everything eloquent right off a teleprompter, but I'm scared. This is scary information. You need to get this out to everybody you know right now. It's all there. You could go check out the headline. We gave you the headlines. Go read the articles. Go to the links. Go read this document right here. Here it is. It says it in plain English. The United States Program for General and Complete Disarmament in a Peaceful World. It's all right there. You better get this information out. Don't waste any more time. You better get some guns. You better get a plan. You better learn how to shoot. Don't waste this time now that we have, because it is precious and the time is running short. Yeah, you know, we had a couple more stories we were going to cover tonight, but I really think I want this to sink in. We're going to go to break. We're going to come back with an Ask Alex segment that we played in segments today on the radio show. But really, you got to let people know about this. Send it out, especially to police and military out there, because they're going to be the ones who are going to get the orders to confiscate those guns. And you know, let me tell you, if they're not oath keepers, they're going to do it. You heard the guy who said, you know, I was gung-ho and I was just following orders. And, you know, go ahead and put up the Prison Planet Ask Alex graphic, because that's a good spot. Planet Infowars is a great place to go to meet like-minded people, to learn how to shoot, talk about guns, talk about bug out plans, to make plans in your community. What are you going to do if it happens like it did in New Orleans during Hurricane Katrina? All right, that's it. We're going to go to break, and we'll be right back after this.
Kristi Hightower here for PlanetInfoWars.com, bringing you your weekly Patriots Are Talking update. Every day, I get more and more excited to see how you Planet InfoWars users are utilizing things like events and missions within groups to come together and share knowledge, or reading your articles where you're sharing your research and your passions. For example, user Paul wrote an article this past week called Activism, Grassroots Activism, and he provides a short explanation for why and how you can exercise your civil rights. Or even on a different subject matter, if you're looking for how plants can heal you and help your health, you should check out Galen's article detailing five great herbs for your skin. Lavender, I think, is among them. And also, lastly, a reminder that we are paying attention to your well-written, well-cited articles. Melissa Melton actually has an article from Planet InfoWars titled CDC Pushes Measles Vaccine. And we've now featured it on the front page of Infowars.com. So if you keep great articles coming like that at us, I guarantee you, you'll get there too. So thanks again for all of your hard work, and keep the knowledge flowing. Till next time, Patriots.
Sick of the globalist eugenicist control freaks adding poison to your water and laughing as you get sick and die? start purifying your water with ProPure. My friends, I've done a lot of research, and the best gravity filter out there, bar none, is ProPure. And it's available discounted at Infowars.com. Its filters are silver impregnated to prevent bacterial growth. There's no priming required. It's NSF 42 certified. Optional fluoride filters can reduce fluoride up to 95%. Easy to set up and use. Doesn't require electricity. Purify water from lakes, streams, ponds, and wells. This filter system leaves in beneficial minerals, which is key. Save money by not buying bottled water and avoid BPA that leaches from the plastic. ProPure is the best gravity-fed filter out there. It's what my family uses. Infowars.com already has the lowest price on ProPure. But if you add the promo code WATER at checkout, you get an additional 10% off at Infowars.com. You can also call to order 888-253-3139.
Welcome. I'm Kristi Hightower here from Planet Infowars. I'm here with our guest, Alex Jones, who's actually answering your questions from the Ask Alex group on planetinfowars.com. This is a special edition marathon version. So we're doing 50 questions. We'll probably cut it up into little parts so that you can stay tuned. So let's get started, Alex. Now, keep that in mind. Keep them short.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. This first one comes to you from Chuck, and he says, you recently had Webster Tarpley on your radio show and asked some great questions, such as, are you a communist? To which Webster replied and elaborated on what he believes and explained as a true American political economic system. And a lot has been going on, and I know that you have numerous issues to cover in very little time, but I'd be interested in hearing what you think of Tarpley's comments about this political system. He speaks of, and he takes a part on libertarians. He had a wealth of information to support his ideas. So
no, that's enough. Yeah, no, I mean, because I did the interview, so I hadn't read the question, but I remember it.
Absolutely.
Look, it's a difference of views, and he claims the American system is this state-directed system, and it really isn't.
Yeah.
Some of what he said's true, and it's all a philosophy, but if you don't have an engaged, informed population that demands liberty and freedom, you're going to have corruption take over, whether it's a libertarian laissez-faire system, whether it's a, you know, state-directed system. When the public becomes a bunch of TV head jellyfish, everything is going to go to hell in a handbasket. And so I, you know, have open debates about a fiat currency run by government or a gold or silver-backed, the Ron Paul, Von Mises view. But overall, government centralized systems get taken over by special interest and become extremely corrupt and generally are the worst system. So, I mean, I've thought long and hard about this. I've read the literature and history across the spectrum, and Tarpley's great on history and great on power structures and the eugenicist. God love him. I saw one commenter one time when somebody called in and asked about him, said, don't be two-faced behind his back, telling this to his face. This is on the radio and TV. This is not behind Tarpley's back. But I promise, next time he's on, I'm going to say, Tarpley, you've got some blind spots. You think we should all take all the vaccines because it's some weird communal proletariat thing. You like McDonald's. You like aspartame, Diet Coke. I mean, he's very proud of this. He goes, what are you going to do, Robinson Crusoe? And I go, no, Robinson Crusoe isn't not taking shots and drinking aspartame and eating chicken McNuggets with silicone in them. So Tarpley's a really smart guy, almost savantish in many ways, because I've been around him personally. He speaks like five languages fluently. But look, I'm savantish in a way. I'm sure everybody is. You know, I've got some spots that are lacking. I like Tarpley. He's kind of like an entertaining mascot around here. I mean, we all like Tarpley as a person. It's just his belief in the state and that the state is the arbiter and is the birth from which all goodness flows. I think he's ass backwards in history.
Absolutely.
So I disagree with him, and that's what I have to say about Mr. Tarpley. Good question. Had to have a longer answer. We've got one question down here at planetinfowars.com, folks. This is where you meet. This is where you get involved. This is where you take action. We're going to have a letter to the editor section. I want to get that set up at the time.
All right.
So folks can send not things that I'm going to comment on, but we're going to have Kristi sit here and read. And then if you have a comment, that's great. Yeah. I think once a week you should read maybe 20 letters.
That'd be awesome.
Four paragraphs or less. Could I have a rule on that? And then just read them. That way your view unfettered goes out. Or I could read them. I mean, whatever.
That would be interesting.
Aaron could read them. Aaron over there running the camera right now because he does such a darn good job.
He has a Facebook following, actually, Aaron.
Aaron's a rock star over there of Liberty. All right, go ahead.
All right, well, this next one comes to you from Keisha, and she says, Alex, if you could go back in time, it's kind of a fun question, actually. If you could go back in time and when you were younger, but still keep all of the knowledge that you have right now, what would that look like? Imagine coming home to the first day of kindergarten being a genius.
Oh, yeah.
Don't we all wish for that?
I don't say I'm a genius now. I've often thought, I think everybody's thought of, think all the mistakes I made. What if I knew all that?
Gosh.
You know, back then. And I think that's where listening to your parents comes from. But we almost genetically are designed to want to get out of the nest, start our own hut, get out of the system. And our parents are telling us things and we're like not listening to them. So there's three ways to learn, I guess. There's by revelation, where it just beams into your head. There's by experience, and there's by being taught. And experience is a great teacher because you really remember it. But it would be better for young folks out there, even if your old man or mom aren't perfect, they care about you. They're going to give you some overall advice that's good. So it's best to not, you know, detest them because in a way you're detesting yourself. And so, I wish I knew.
Is there a day you want
back then what I know now? What?
Is there a particular day you would want to go back to, like that you think about?
I wish that when some bully started a fight with me, that I just learned to back down when I could, because it was just pointless. I like all those brain cells I'm missing from having my head slammed in the concrete and, you know, going to jail and stuff like that. I mean, I would have been less confrontational. But in a way, again, that's catch 22, because I wouldn't be who I am today if I hadn't grown up where I did in Dallas and seen the things I saw. So whatever. I mean, there's no going back. Unless you try to teach your children what you've gone through. But they haven't experienced it yet, so they're not going to listen.
Right.
You know, later you're like, oh, Dad, Mom, you were sure right about that. Man, I wish I'd listened to you. That's older you get, the more right your parents get. You know?
It's kind of scary, actually.
Yeah.
All right, well, this next one comes to you from Chris, and he says, Alex, a question. Are things so different here in the UK? One thing I've noticed from campaigning in the UK is that the US campaigning is so much more vitriolic. Do you feel you need a louder voice in the U.S. to get noticed, or is it just plain wrong? Is that wrong?
Well, I mean, you can do stunts in the media to get noticed, but I've noticed we've inadvertently done stunts before, mm-hmm. where it's the right thing the media picks up, but then they still control the message. It's like you put out something that they're ready to pick up and make big. It's because they can spin it to their advantage.
Right.
So I've never really been calculating about what I do. You know, it's more of, I think this is important. This is what I'm thinking, feeling. I like to impart this. And some of it resonates with people. Some of it doesn't. So it is what it is. That's why it's important with things like planetinfowars.com that people get together there, start their own campaigns, get involved, meet others. Because there are people watching out there right now who are smarter than I am, more eloquent than I am, more informed, who've had life experiences that are going to be, you know, bring pieces of the puzzle that I can't cover. That's why I'm trying to hire all these great reporters and bring in other graphics people and expend the capital I've accrued to try to really go to the next level. Because I realize this is a very important position we're in. And that's why a lot of times it'll be midnight and I shoot a video and upload it. It's because I realize, man, we've got this limited window to actually affect change for the good.
It's a key time in history.
Right? What question are we up to now?
We're up to number four.
Am I moving fast?
You are moving fast. I'm very
continue proud. The interrogation.
Here it goes. This is actually from user Tofu, clever username. I'm a former active duty Marine. I live in Okinawa, Japan, and I listen to your show every day, over and over, the rebroadcast and all of that. I believe in you, Alex. So I've woken up a few friends, and they listen to me like you do. When I go on airbase, they scan our civilian ID cards, and I'm a prepper. But my friends think I'm a kook, which I thought was kind of cute language. Do you think things would become bad for American citizens living abroad like me?
Statistically, in a world financial collapse that's designed to bring in world government, it will be worse to be in areas where you're not indigenous just because you don't fit in, you don't blend in with the culture. When things get rough, you'll be the first person gets turned on. I don't want to geographically say something about, you know, an island off Japan, because you know more about that area than I do because you live there. So I think your question states the concern and the knowledge you already have. But, you know, if it does, cultural bounds mean nothing, because we're all human in the final equation. If you've got really good friends you've known for years, you know, the cultural differences can be bridged there. It's just that, I don't know, the Japanese are known for being the opposite of lawless. So Japan's a pretty good place to be during a crisis. I mean, you think Americans would act that polite and nice during a nuclear meltdown? You got nothing. It'd be looting, mass murder, and death, and burning cities if we had something like you had. I mean, instead, like, crime went down when they got hit by tidal waves and had reactors blow up.
Crazy.
Instead, here, it'd be like,
oh, yeah.
So, I mean, I don't know. Now, after thinking about your geographic and cultural locale, even though it's an island, things are more expensive. You're an island off an island. You said Okinawa, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's a problem for cost during a collapse. But I don't know. I mean, there couldn't be a more...
kind, forgiving people?
Yeah, I mean, just orderly, focused, people too prideful to be crooks on average in the Japanese. So I'm not going to judge it, but it's a mixed bag.
All right, this next one comes to you from Noah, and he says, is there any proof that British Labour Party politicians, John Smith and Robin Cook, were assassinated by associates of Tony Blair? I think that kind of alludes to it.
Yeah, there's overwhelming evidence that happened. People can look into it. When they would come out and say Al-Qaeda's fake, the government runs it, boom, you'd have a heart attack next day. They kill people all the time. You had Dr. David Kelly said, they've told me I'll be killed and found in the woods if I tell you, but it's all fake. There's no WMDs. And then a guy walking his dog sees five guys in black uniforms leaving the body, running away. The wrists are slit, no blood at the scene. Then they say he took pills and died, but two undissolved pills were in his stomach.
This one comes to you from, forgive me if I can't say it right, Vitham, I think. Alex, I've heard you mention some things about Ronald Reagan's assassination attempt and the medical care he received afterwards that somehow diminished his mental capacity. I've been unable to find anything else on this. Could you expand on the topic a bit? Maybe provide a resource material?
Well, here's the good news and the bad news. I'm not looking at these questions beforehand. Sometimes she'll ask me a question about one of them because she wants to know before we go to them. But I have not seen your questions, so I don't have time to go look up the stuff, because if we did, we'd never even get to this.
Yeah.
Multiple guests over the years. I think TV news pieces were done at the time that, you know, Reagan was incapacitated a few weeks because of some cold blood he was given. And if you do that, it can cause kind of like a overall stroke-like effect in the brain. The fact that he would be asleep for days, then suddenly be animated, and the word is they use that to kind of get control of him medically. But we should look into that. Perhaps you can do it, Kristi, for next time. Well, so we can special. Like put a star and then come back and say, before we get to new questions, let's go to a question from last time.
Yeah, we're going to have to do kind of a recap of some past episodes where we finalized some answers there.
Yeah, because, again, I already said it. The problem is I can't sit here and then have a documented bibliographed answer every time.
You don't have that on your...
Well, no, not if it's on the fly. Not if it's on the fly.
Yeah, no kidding. This next one comes to you from Glenn. He says, smoking used to be ubiquitous. It was everywhere, TV, billboards, movies, even in comic books. Smokers are some of the most stubborn people I know. In your opinion, was smoking a beta test for getting rid of an individual's rights?
Yes, it is. I mean, it was Edward Bernays and other propagandists that helped sell that, you know, be radical, be a feminist, smoke cigarettes in the 20s and 30s, liberty torches. And then the system decided, you know, for whatever reason, okay, well, we can kill them through vaccines and GMO. Let's have the test to ban something that people know is unhealthy. And the next, it's popcorn, milk products, and soft drinks and salt. Now, not in New York, but spreading all over. So it's kind of a globalist system where they try to get standardized laws all over the world. And yes, it was undoubtedly a beta test. I mean, they're one of the oldest men in the world, over 105 years old, smokes a pack of cigarettes every day. I'm not saying it's good. Genetically, some people can handle it. Other people, it's a death warrant. Not a good idea to be pulling a bunch of dirty smoke. It's not just the tobacco. They had hundreds of chemicals in those things to make them more addictive, to make you smoke more.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the weird thing is I've always smoked on and off, cigars, cigarettes, you name it. I'm a big tobacco guy. But one time for 6 years I quit, where suddenly it stunk and I didn't like it. And finally, again, about a year ago, I quit, and now it stinks and it's horrible. I have no desire for it. So it's like, thank God, I actually prayed to get me off those things, and it happened, because now when I smell somebody smoking a cigarette, it makes me want to throw up. And I used to wonder why I'd be outside a restaurant or something smoking a cigarette, and people walk by and go, oh, we got to smell your smoke. I'd get mad at them. But now I really get it. It's like, as I smell it, it just smells like...
It's interesting what knowledge does to you, too. I mean, the more you learn about how bad something is, you like cultivate this desire to really get rid of it. I mean, the idea of like what it does to your lungs or how it affects your body.
Oh, it's also, you know how many radioactive isotopes are in it?
Oh, I
didn't even know this, but like somehow it's strange that tobacco puts, it's weird. People can look it up. It sounds crazy. But I had, during Fukushima, I'd already quit smoking, so it's over a year now, but I had nuclear physicist Dr. Bob Bowman on the show.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, well, don't worry too much about Fukushima. They're getting a lot of radiation, but what we get is less than somebody that smokes cigarettes for a few years. He goes, you know, you get all these rads off of smoking. And I went and I thought, that's crazy. So I'm looking it up, and I didn't know it was, like, well known. That tobacco, I guess. Oh, side issue. Go ahead to the next point.
Yeah, no, that's fascinating.
We're obviously going to get through 50. Let's do 20. We'll do 25 tomorrow.
No, okay, we'll just.
What's the next one?
This one is actually a more complex question. It says allied governments are covering up non-HIV cases, and this girl actually, her name is Kayla, and she says like mine under the chronic fatigue syndrome, and how can HIV deemed to cause AIDS when there are millions of non-HIV AIDS cases? And I actually researched a little bit of this on my own. In 1993, the CBC actually said that if your T-cell count is less than 200, then you have HIV. And so it skyrocketed those number of cases. So, I mean...
Yeah, you don't have the virus, but you have an autoimmune disorder.
Right.
Which is actually things they've done through different vaccines, foods, and things. They're actually engineering it, and it's a very complex issue. And then HIV is really the cover for other bioweapons they're running in Africa. I mean, why is it? The BBC even had to admit like a decade ago that they went and checked all these women, the young women that had HIV, and they checked them, and they had never had intercourse. So how did they have HIV? And they said, well, it must have been dirty needles in the vaccine process. So how is it that someone in the West can have hundreds of partners and not get it, but people that haven't ever had any partners, I mean, oh, they're having a lot of sex over in Africa. No, they're shooting them up with it. And then with it is a trace virus, HIV, which they're always claiming is changing. It's just the covered excuse for bioweapons operations that are going on. So it's a very sophisticated, topic.
Yeah, something about it expanded to like pneumonia, like all the STDs. I mean, it was like a huge, huge situation. That'd be an interesting one.
It's just a general cover name. Yeah. And then Big Pharma sells a bunch of drugs to people that are like chemo drugs that kill them.
Yeah, AZT was actually like the number one causing killer for liver. Like your liver would fail if you took AZT back in the 80s.
Yeah.
Anyways, sorry, side note. this is actually kind of a combination of questions, but it's along the same topic. It's from Blade Runner and Authoritarian Hater. So when I tell sheeple about aspartame and smart meters, they all look at me like I'm nuts. So their answer to my aspartame warning is, yeah, right, I feel fine, I don't have rashes, headaches, etc. So how do I explain it? The same with the smart meters. They don't believe me, and they say so, and then they tell me to prove it. And it seems to me like they just want to contradict the idea that it's so out there.
Sure. They've been given hypnotic programming. This is on record through the television. They're in a near dreamlike state. When you upset them out of their trance state, they get upset and say, prove it. And even if you prove it, they don't want to hear it.
Right.
I mean, it's admitted aspartame is causing all these medical problems. It's not debated. Back in the 80s when they approved it, they knew that. It's not debated there's a world government, but they'll still laugh at you and say it doesn't exist, even though it's in the newspapers. And people like that are just damaged goods. You got to move on past them. Because they're so afraid at a subconscious level, and they've been so programmed, they're going to put up a defense. It's like an obsessive, compulsive thing. And a lot of them think you're showing off when you try to warn them. Because they would never try to warn anybody. They've got such a low self-image that they don't care about warning others. So they think you're showing off to them, and like they're pathetic.
Right.
And it's also a childlike delusional, you know, where they think if they deny something, magically it goes away. So there's a lot of psychological things, and they are sad little victims that we got to triage them. We try to warn them. Don't feel bad when they attack you. Move on to the next zombie. Because some zombies have not succumbed to the full zombiosis yet, okay? And so you just have to move on from that person to the next person. Okay, this one I can't help. I've got to move on.
That's awesome. Yeah, keep moving forward. I like that.
But it's not just zombies, and there's vampire control agents, to use a popular term, you know, use something popular, you know, who are like into the evil. They know something's going on, like moths to flame. They want to serve it as like Renfield, as if they're going to get out of it by doing that. And they know they can manipulate. They know the public's asleep, and they're swimming around like a, you know, vampire eel around the unconscious person, going, "Don't wake them up," you know, like a little bulldog swimming around them. loving the fact that they're on and they can program them, getting off on the power that they have a sleeping person they can manipulate. You understand that?
So many sci-fi movies just popped into my head right now.
Well, I mean, there's so many levels to this, but there's a lot of yuppies and people that are into the, like, oh, I can make money and be powerful in the system, but they're asleep at another level as well. Right. It's only master, you know, social engineer level that has the whole image in their mind.
It's a desire for truth that I think people are truly scared of. All right, so this comes from Jisk. He actually wrote an accompanying article for it. I'll reference it here in a second. He says, have you looked into Leo Wanta and these trillions of dollars?
Yeah, not true. Not real.
It's not true.
Not true. Not
okay.
real.
Mm-hmm. Well, there you go. There you have it.
I mean,
yeah,
it's not as real as the Easter Bunny. I mean, you know. It's not as real. I love talking about Easter Bunny. That's a little joke.
You always make me giggle when you say that.
I don't know. Whatever. I overdo it. The point is, it's so ridiculous. It's as real as those Nigerian letters you get in the mail.
Okay. The scamish idea.
Well, maybe they're real. I mean, I've had people call me up and go, hey, I got this Nigerian letter. They're offering me $1 million. I pay them $5,000. They want to believe their ships come in.
Yeah.
And I go, no, that's about a 10-year-old internet scam. It's not real. And I've had family, distant family say, no, my million is here. I'm sending my $5,000. And then you send your $5,000, and then you get the email back on, oh, that wasn't quite enough. $5,000 more is needed. And sometimes they do 4 or 5 payments. And you know who they're angry at after they get ripped off?
You, for telling them the truth.
They're not angry at the Nigerian scammer because they always get an email that Prince Habib got arrested.
Of course.
I mean, it wasn't that he couldn't pay. Prince Habib got arrested. People, once they're getting scammed, they just get deeper and deeper into the fraud.
Yeah.
I mean, and that's what they want. It's what they get.
This next one comes to you from John, and he says, Alex, did you know that in the big re-education camp PDF that you discovered weeks ago, there was a section where they talk about the Army squatting community centers? Can you clarify what a FEMA DRC, Disaster Recovery Center, actually is? There's actually one located near me.
Well, again, there are real disasters. There's real reasons for this. So they kind of cluster real issues of hurricanes, earthquakes within it. That's part of it. And then it just has takeover of local government, gun confiscation. It's all, so there's some legitimate functions, and that's how they always sell it. Kind of like the Army does Jaws of Life for car wrecks. Like, well, are you against the Army being here? They're just helping this poor man.
Yeah.
Are you against the Air Force spraying mosquitoes in Florida? That's our military getting the job done. So there's just this mission creep where it's just an acclamation, and they do things that they think are going to be popular up front. So the troops feel good being in the community. Right. The troops being brainwashed too. So it's just a conditioning process for the police, the military, the public. We're all in the same boat.
Yeah. Well, this next one actually comes to you from Freedom Angel. What do you know about Project Athena? How come Catherine Albrecht never talked about it, being from MIT, as she had some dealings with them?
I have no idea. You'll have to look into this. I have.
We'll start that question.
Yeah, I have no. Special. Might as well ask me about Lucky Charms or something.
Sometimes they jump over the rainbow.
Yeah, no, I mean, all that was Greek.
All right, well, this next one comes to you from Tori, and she says, why do some states like Texas have state guards, and how powerful are they in relation to the police departments, the regular military?
Ooh, that's a good question.
Yeah, you kind of touched on that today in today's show. I heard you say something about state police or something to that effect. So,
well, I mean, I'm actually trying to work on a piece on this. It's funny that they asked that question. That's the original vestigial shadow of the state militia. Because all the state militia was, they demonized the news, was a posse or a civil defense. So that if the sheriff, who's elected, needs a group of people for fires or for whatever, he can go around and find out, or she can go around and find out whoever they think's good and whoever's willing to do, get something done. Hey, you know, you got bulldozers. There's fires coming this way. Get over here. You know, get on the radio. Get on local radio, TV. Back in the old days, you know, ride on your horse. Hey, get down here. We need help. You know, get your buckets. The town's on fire. And so states have guards, and then they also have the National Guard. Originally, it was state guards, and they set up National Guard. It was under the governors. Now they basically federalize those, where they're federal, so they're even getting rid of the state having its, quote, National Guard. And so it's really what's left of the militia.
Awesome. That's actually really informative. The Mitzier E is this user. What do you think about Romney saying no congressional approval needed to bomb Iran? And he's not alone in saying that.
Hey, he likes Obama's health care, you know, saying he says he's against it, but he helped write it. But we got to do what the Supreme Court said, and the IRS taxing us isn't a tax. And it's a standard NDAA. He supports secret arrest, drone killing, endless war, warrantless wiretappings, open borders, carbon taxes. He's bought and paid for by the exact same people. Bain's given double the money that he's part owner of and used to head to Obama than they even gave him. Mitt Romney. So, I mean, Mitt Romney is it's just the fix is in. If they don't steal the election, they don't need to. Yep. They got Mitt Romney. They win whether they steal it, whether Obama gets in, whether it's Mitt Romney. I mean, Mitt Romney might as well be, I got an idea. How about Mitt Romney be VP for Obama? You know, Joe Biden can get out of there and we'll just, I mean, it's just, but it's like, but we're beating Obama. We're going to get Mitt Romney in there.
Yeah, of course. Do you see that cartoon we had on Infowars today? It was the sheep and it was like, whichever way you choose, and it all funneled into the same place.
I didn't see it, but yeah.
Fits into that. Vaughn comes to you and he asks, Alex, I'm curious to get your take on the inevitable emerging cloning technology and the implications on society.
Well, clones have inherent genetic problems, and it's all part of humanity playing God. Just like an iPhone has tech built into it that you pay for when you buy it to spy on you, the globalists have said with their medical tyranny that they're not going to give us any, you know, like they sterilize us, but then come and say we have a technology so you can have a child.
Right.
But then they're going to get rid of traits that are bad in the child. That means build into it what they want. And so this whole thing is a medical mad scientist tyranny, and it's strap yourselves in. We're going to see some very, very crazy times, but we should do a whole special on cloning because we're already eating clone meat, milk from clone cows. They're doing cross-species weird clones. I mean, the sky's the limit. We're living in, this planet is like a giant biological weapons experiment or something.
Yeah, you don't know what's real anymore. Glitch says, as a child, I read Prisoners of Power. It's a sci-fi book written by a Russian duo. And the brothers back in the night, they wrote it in the 1960s. Since then, I've read the book many times, discovering new aspects of the world that they painted. In 2010 and 2011, the biggest sci-fi movie ever made in Russia came out in two parts. The name of the movie was Inhabited Island. And essentially, the story parallels many of today's trends. So probably some of the most notable of them are radiation towers affecting people's minds, propaganda, brainwash, etc. So I'm not sorry, I kind of lost my question. Can we find other articles that are like that? Is there any other like sci-fi movie or anything else that you've seen? I've noticed articles that, you know, we see a cartoon that it's painted the future, etc.
Yeah, I mean, all these movies and culture show a dystopia. It's like, just get ready for it. That's what happens. In the future, the government says how many kids you can have. In the future, you're going to be watched and controlled because eugenicists developed most of the modern technologies we have. They steered them. They controlled them. The robber barons and royalty believed in all this, so they've built the culture we're in, and this is the world they're taking us to. I haven't seen that film or read that book, but it sounds intriguing.
Yeah. Well, maybe we'll follow up with that, too. Everyone, this is from Freedom Spear, and he says, everyone knows that having preventative medicine, surgery, and dental work, whatever, is not an inalienable right. And we actually touched on that in one of the last Ask Alex segments. Moreover, passing a law that mandates purchasing such services, products, anything else is completely unconstitutional and very illegal. We've covered it. What organization or enforcement arm has the authority to arrest the Supreme Court justices responsible for this illegal activity?
Congress can defund them. Congress, it's not really a separation of powers the way we've been taught. Congress is dominant. Then there's the courts. Then there's the executive. So there's a separation of powers, but because Congress is 500-plus people, it's got the real power. And that's why the globalists have sold it out and gotten it to be weakened and transferred into 9 justices they can control and 1 president and then a bureaucracy. But it's up to the states to nullify and not follow and fight. It's up to us individually, because it's not like they're trying to give free health care to people that others pay for. It's these are eugenicist tyrants that are now using this to control people. So that's the main issue with the health care takeover.
Good. The next one is from Thomas, and he says,
"If what's the bottom one? We'll do this page. We'll do the other half tomorrow.
Oh, okay.
We'll do the 24. That's just about half.
We're at, yeah. We'll finish this this page.
I said I'd do 50, but my goodness gracious.
I know, you're
good. Hey, I'm moving quick, though.
I'm very impressed. We should
feel like I'm being interrogated, though.
Where's the light? Right over your head. If you don't, this is from Thomas, and he says, if you don't know your history, you're doomed to repeat it, which I think is valid. My question is, you started talking about Vietnam, Yugoslavian wars, et cetera, and what was the real cause, I was wondering? And I understood the breaking news about the New World Order every day, but I would love to hear a history lesson from your perspective. So.
Well, I mean, it's not that the communists in Vietnam were good guys. Ho Chi Minh came to the CIA and the U.S. government and said, I want to set up a system with you, a free system. And they said, no, we're going to have the corrupt narcotics traffickers in the South still run things. We're going to prop up, you know, the Indochina French model. And so they turned against us. And CIA staged bombings to blame the North to get the war going and put advisors in 1960, really 59. And the rest is history, but it doesn't mean the communist Chinese then backing the northern Vietnamese. That doesn't mean they're good. It's like just because our government's corrupt doesn't mean Iran's good. It's like corruption across the board. As for Yugoslavia, I mean, you have Tito, who was a balancing force. They get rid of him. They break it up. They engage in the bombing of Belgrade with the depleted uranium. I mean, it's all just about destroying nation states that the bankers don't control. And as bad as Assad is in Syria or Gaddafi was in Libya, they're putting something far worse in. So when you hear about, freedom fighters are just trying to protest, it's Al-Qaeda blowing up police stations and lining up black people in Libya and shooting them. And the media is like, this guy might have said a word. We better fire him. But, you're lining up blacks and shooting them? Well, that's nice.
Yeah.
And Bill Gates has a shot for the little black child. George Bush is hugging one. The child's crying. You know, it's all just an AFRICOM invasion PR.
Yeah, they've done actually studies where the government has proven that, they had this skepticism of advertising working, and I studied a case study in college on it, and it was basically they went in with the idea that it doesn't work, but obviously they know it works, and that they show Bill, like George Bush with little children, like you said, and things of that nature. Anyways, side note.
But imagine how ridiculous it would be.
It's a Kristi rant,
If I had a black child come in here and then shot a thing with me going, I mean, people will be like, my God, Alex, this is ridiculous. But then it's George Bush and the photos everywhere. Meanwhile, AFRICOM is running in just slaughtering everybody, arming the dictators. And they're doing it in North Africa and South Africa, thousands of miles from Kony, who hadn't been seen in 5 years. And they admit, it's transparent. I mean, it's just like.
Right.
I mean, the UN is in Africa, in Uganda, where they're talking about Kony, on record. Lining up people and killing whole villages to take their property. And you go tell a trendy, they're like, look, dude, I got tattoos. I got all this. I'm like, okay, I don't care if you got tattoos. I'm not against those. They're like, look, I'm dressed trendy. Don't tell me Kony's not cool. And I'm like, but it's slaughtering people. And they go, dude, your hair does not look like mine right now. And I'm just like, okay, I understand you're super trendy and everything. But, I mean, come on. And it's just like, and they're like, look, I choose to believe we're helping Africa. And I'm just like, okay. They're like, be quiet, racist.
Yeah.
And it's just like, okay, all right. I mean, it's buying into the delusion. It's like, I'm a winner. I buy into the propaganda.
The next question comes to you from Husband and Dad. That's the username. Alex, you present yourself extremely well as a benchmark of civil disobedience. And there are a large number of activists that would do better if they were just a bit more civil. So could you, in your own words, define civil disobedience?
Well, I don't think I'm the benchmark of anything, really, but maybe alternative media success, but that's just because a lot of people aren't trying. Civil disobedience just means you're not Molotov cocktailing the police station. Instead, you're saying no to things that are clearly wrong and kind of peacefully sabotaging the system and putting yourself against the machinery.
Very succinct. I like that. Charles asks you, he says, Alex, my question is, could we abolish the Fed without the government's help, or is it impossible?
Yes, just like people are abolishing GMO foods by demanding organic.
Mm-hmm.
And none of it's perfect, but there's a process there, voting with dollars. That's why they want to get a tyranny in, because they're scared if we just vote with our dollars and our actions and the little things we do, it's over for them. It's game over.
Absolutely.
Yes, if everybody started doing more barter, that's why they're attacking all these little farms and Amish and these community co-ops and things, it really scares them. Getting back to old-fashioned activities in any way. Women, men, learning how to make their own clothes. That's one of the biggest things that scares the system. I said that because you said your mom made that, that nice coat you got. A jacket, work sports jacket, whatever you call it. I mean, they're really scared of that. Just the idea of little things cuts into their monopoly. That's what I mean, like, picture the New World Order is this giant box store that basically resorbs you or absorbs you. So what was the question?
It was just, you know, how to be civil disobedient.
Yeah, that's it. Just.
Oh, no, that was the last question. I'm so sorry. Destroying the Fed without intervention from the government.
You just criticize it. You expose it as a private fraud, that it's the biggest welfare recipient, that it's taken over our country and the world, that they brag they've conquered us. Look how arrogant they are. And using local alternative currencies, they've got all sorts of them in all over the country, all over the world. And just realizing they're the enemy. You know, Obama comes, you know, politicians come and go, but still the big fat bankers are sitting there.
I like that. Barter. Well, that's the civil rights movement was a huge part of that. They withdrew from riding the buses. And then they started...
Well, exactly. And cab driving. Also supporting local businesses. And it doesn't mean you're a purist, because you can't be. I mean, you can't buy a locally made electro voice microphone. I think that's made in Germany or Japan. I mean, this is made in Germany. Mm. You and nothing against the Germans. This is actually a quality product. We actually hire some workers that actually, you know, get something out of it, which is good. They put back in the economy. But buying local really does do something.
Or bartering. Anders asks, howdy, Alex. I like that's very Texas of you, Anders. If fractional reserve banking would be replaced by another system, what would it be replaced with? For example, an interest-free monetary system, would that work in practice?
We debated that. It could be interest-free from state banks. I don't know about a federal bank, because that can always get taken over. But if you had state banks, they've had some big successes with that. And that's what we talked about in the first question, or one of the first, was this issue of people go, well, you've got Tarpley on, who's for an interest-free, you know, system, but by a big federal bank, the Hamiltonian model. And then you got Ron Paul on over here, who is... You know, talking about gold or silver backed, so you can't. Any of these systems can be manipulated and gamed. It's mainly about a debate and monetary, people being informed monetarily so that the system, because they can corrupt any system, but if the people are informed about monetary systems, that gives a leg up against it.
Knowledge is where you start, and then it's action from there that's what it's leading to. Warwick asks, Alex, mainstream media is now openly reporting horrific things such as the idea of afterbirth abortion, thousands of elderly people being intentionally killed. Is this mainstream news, ultimately he's asking, is this showing that we're winning? Like they're actually reporting on something that we find to be true, or are they just kind of throwing us a bone?
I used to think that all this stuff coming out was victories. And it's a mixed bag. Sometimes a reporter gets it through, an editor says it's the right thing to do. And I know in the last decade, that last 5 or 6 years, that really started where people went out and did real reporting. Their boss backed them because maybe the newspaper editor's New World Order, but now their kid's autistic. They figure out this is important. Mm-hmm. They allow it out. So more and more people started getting the truth out. So the system kind of just went, okay, yeah, we're going to kill old people. What's the big deal? Yeah, we're going to kill kids up to age 3 if we want. So it's people telling the truth and hitting the barbed wire to get the truth out. Well, that is a victory. But there's also a lot of just acclimating. Oh, you want the truth to come out? Yeah, open the floodgates. And suddenly in hundreds of papers, we're run by foreign banks. We're your slaves. You've been conquered by world government. There's nothing you can do about it. So see, it's kind of like the system's gone from denying all this because they realized people weren't listening to them. It was discrediting them denying things. So they've kind of just gone to a now open the floodgates. Oh, you think there's some tyranny? Yeah, this is what you didn't know was going on. What you gonna do about that? And you're like, oh my God, and there's hell itself right there. And they're like, yeah. So it's a lot of things. And also their agenda now is moving into light speed, so they can't hide it anymore.
You know, they also do this in a monotone voice, if you notice. Like, does it...
They don't want you being emotional.
Of course.
I was never successful on purpose, whereas I wasn't angry and they're always like, don't get upset in politics. Don't be calm. That's how you get through to people. Bull crap. When everybody is in a drone, mesmerized state, they need to be awakened by it, by having their survival mechanisms in their mind activated. And I'm a guy hopping around like a dog barking. I mean, it'd be like if robbers were breaking into your house, you get up and they're like crowbarring open your garage or whatever, your car, and you look at the German Shepherd and you go, shut up, I can't believe you were barking. That is so extreme of you to be barking at them. You know, we get upset and motivated for a reason. So I'm kind of like, rrr, 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 rrr. They're like, no, that's not how you get through to people. Everybody's like in a zombie state of sleep, and I'm like, rrr, rrr. And they're like, no, that's extreme. Don't listen to him. There's nothing going on out there.
In the employee handbook. Whoa, 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 whoa. This is how we do it around here. I See the Future user asked you, in 1998, the movie Ants shows grass, lawn made into exact shapes of New York Twin Tower skyline. How does Hollywood know a false flag years in advance? Obviously, it's all kind of coordinated.
I haven't seen that clip, but there are literally, no exaggeration, 60, 70, I was about to say hundreds, it's probably in the hundreds, of news articles, things about pre-9/11.
Mm-hmm.
And the worst example, best example, it's horrible, is Fox Television had the Lone Gunman spinoff of that big hit show they had, X-Files. And in it, the government hijacks a jumbo passenger jet to fly to the World Trade Centers to blame it on Afghanistan. And they use a drill to claim that hijackers got on board to cover up the fact that it's really remote control. Now, that's exactly what happened 6 months later. So I'm pointing out this is a government op. And then I get a call. Dean Haglund, the star of the show, once he was in the X-Files, too, wants to come to my house and talk to me. And he shows up. It's Dean Haglund from television. He goes, yeah, the CIA approached us and planted that story. And they did it with others. Well, I mean, obviously, why do they do that then? It's like a pre-programming thing.
Ties back into that news idea.
Yes. So subconsciously, you're ready for it. But also, it's a message so the bankers that run the CIA, they can say to the Russians and others, we're not going to say who did 9/11, but did you see Fox's Lone Gunman? Don't play games with us, okay? If we'll do that, we'll do anything. We're ready for nuclear war with you. You submit and do what we want, and you shoot your people up with cancer viruses, or you're all dead, too. So they put these in messages so they can go, we're not going to tell you what we're going to do, but have you seen this movie?
Right.
How many other movies we make come true? And I saw this with Gary Hart. I saw this with Gary Hart when he wrote a letter to Ahmadinejad saying, we've staged terror attacks before, we'll do it again. He published it in the Huffington Post. And when Luke Radowski, or it was other folks we had changed, I forget, but it's in our film, Truth Rising. They confront him. He goes, I didn't write that. When they pull the letter, he goes, oh, I did, but it's a mock letter. He started sweating and freaking out. Like, I got one that can see. He couldn't believe that was happening. I mean, that's a really great question right there. They just asked, what's the last one for today? 26 tomorrow. I just did 24, and I'm going to go shoot the news right now. No rest for the wicked. I didn't know I was this wicked, but...
All right, so Sovereign Think asks you, this is the last question, so this is technically 24. What are your thoughts on the NSTIC program? Is it dangerous as I think? Is it as dangerous as I think required biometric access for the internet?
5 years, 3 or 4 years ago, they already had that built into the new Microsoft stuff, and that's what they plan, is an internet ID so they can tax you, track you, trace you. And Google's already changing stuff so they know who you really are. You have multiple accounts so they can ban you from the internet.
I'm not familiar with it. Is it like a thumbprint situation?
Yeah, they're going to make you thumbprint and face scan to buy and sell, get on the internet, you name it. If you're not a good globalist, you can't travel, you can't live, you can't do anything. And people will be like, I don't want to help you. They'll turn my ID off. And so it'll be the ultimate fear. And if they get to that point, it's going to be devastating. Like, I can't upload Alex Jones videos. He's been banned before. And if you do, you get banned from the system. I need my creds on my card. And I need it. So, I mean, it is absolute takeover by that little criminal Bill Gates.
Well,
and that is a hell of a way to end it. I want to start back with that when I'm fresh tomorrow.
All right, we'll just reissue that.
We'll start over with 24 because that is an incredibly important question.
Absolutely.
All of them were great. PlanetInfoWars.com. Go there, meet, use the web while we've still got it. Organize. It's in beta, but it's working a lot better than it was a few months ago when we first launched it.
Absolutely.
Spread the word about it. Make your own YouTube videos about it. PlanetInfoWars.com. Kristi, take us out of here.
Thank you all so much for tuning in. Keep your questions coming. They're amazing to read. Ask Alex on planetinfowars.com.